I'm with my student. So my name is Kevin, and I just want to say thank you to Carrie and to all the grad students, because I'm learning a lot right now. This is a project, the kind of which I've never been able to participate in before, and so to just come into town as a visiting artist and to have an opportunity like this already opened up and to be able to work on it is kind of amazing. And the other thing I just realized as we were lost and trying to find our way here is that my grandmother and my grandfather actually met and were married at FSU, so I'm allowed to thank the school for this. So I'm going to talk kind of assuming that a lot of you guys are studying art or are interested in art and are interested in kind of how we develop in our lives as artists. I'm getting a little too old to do this, but what I do is I kind of start like when I was in college, and then I just like fast forward through to like everything I've ever done. So it's a lot of information and it's kind of fast. But the reason that I do it that way is because I feel like that a lot of people, you know, this is sort of where you guys are coming from. You're in school right now, you're sort of asking yourselves a lot of questions about what you will make and how the sort of road plays out ahead of you. And so I'm trying to, you know, think about that. A couple things I want to get out of the way, because they always, people always ask and I forget to mention it. I'm 33, and I have lots of different projects that I fund, and I mostly fund them through making drawings and selling them. So when you're seeing a lot of these big projects, there's fundraisers, and there's like drawings, and there's this kind of like backstory of how these things come together, but I just wanted to get that out of the way, because people at the end are always like, hey, forgot to mention that. So anyway, I'm just gonna sort of go through a lot of images. This is a recent installation that I have made. This is a series of boats that I created that we went down the various rivers from Mississippi to the canals of Venice. And this is the place where I started, which is printmaking. And I have a lot of different ways of working. And for me, trying to sort of tell the narrative of why I work in all these different ways, how they're all related, and how my thought process tends to snake through all these different thought forms and different mediums is, for me, it's like, it kind of tells the story of who I am as an artist and why what I think is particular to my life. So, you know, when I was in school, I was coming from Daytona Beach, Florida. I was, you know, this was ages ago, before the internet, so my exposure to a lot of things was quite limited. I had a pretty classical background in painting. And then I moved to New York City, and this thing happened to me where my whole idea of what art could be got turned upside down. And it really sort of, I had a kind of a crisis about like what is painting about and why am I doing this, and these little squares on the walls and sort of like the whole commercial gallery system and everything. And so in a kind of like wildly silly and strange to me at the time maneuver, I started making thousands and millions of tiny little stickers and posters. And at the time, you know, I was looking around and I was asking myself the question of, how do I make things which are physically part of my world? How do I make things which have context in my everyday life? And I was totally in love with the city, and I was in love with the collages and the layers and the scribbles and the tears, and just the way that the city walls in New York have this way of inviting people, and sort of people are layering over, and there's this kind of, it's aggressive, and it's loud, and it's messy, and it's beautiful, and it's kind of like this organic moment. And I felt like I understood the language of painting a lot better, and I felt also that I didn't want at that moment to imitate any of those, the language of painting, which seemed to me to be arising from the sort of language of the city, but I wanted to participate directly in it. So really not knowing what I was doing, I just started making these kind of really weird, ugly series of like paintings and drawings, and finding every way that I could to become part of the city with it. So this is like a scroll newspaper box, and you know, just distributing free art out of it. And there was a lot of low level billboards, which actually turned out were illegal. I didn't realize at the time, but I would organize groups of people to take over them and to cover them with paintings. We would replace ads in subways, and just, you know, it sort of became an obsession. It was like once I had started, it just tipped over something in my mind. I told myself at the time, like, oh, I'll do this for about a month. And that was like, what, I don't know, 12 years ago? So it just somehow, like, had a way of capturing my mind and becoming a total obsession. And I would just, like, scour the city and think about every different way that I could sort of infiltrate. This is taking the manifest covers off the plate. And, you know, and I think that like any artist, I had this kind of long, awkward, weird period of being like, what am I making? What am I doing? Why am I doing these things? And it was just this total compulsion and I couldn't stop. And then somewhere in there, I started to think about animation shadow puppets and about creating a shadow puppet on a wall where the wall would kind of show through instead of light and puppet, sort of like the wall coming through. And I was a waitress, I was a student, I couldn't afford big black subliminal, which is what I really wanted, and so I thought, well, okay, shadow puppets, they just punch holes in leather. And so I took a big roll of paper and I started cutting it up to make portraits. And I remember that first time that I made this portrait, which is the one in the center, it's of my grandfather, the one who actually was married here at FSU. And I just made the drawing, and I remember laying it on the floor and just going like, okay, something different has happened. And I could feel like something had entered the room, and like something kind of changed in my process. And then similarly, when I started to go outside with it, it was a totally different feeling. I could feel the characters interacting with the walls, and also the way that people would react to what I was doing changed entirely, whereas before they were kind of like, oh, is this like an SS you're making? Suddenly people were like, hey, what is that? Who is that? What is that about? And so it became something that really drew me forward. And I started to work also in linoleum blocks. Here's a block print. I have a bunch of process shots in here too, because I figured that's something that people probably want to see a bit of. And you know, working outside is amazing because the work that you make takes on this life, and it rots and it decays, and people scribble over it, and there are a thousand different stories that collect around it. You know, I still to this day hear stories about things that happened 10 years ago, or like, you know, decisions that people made because they stumbled upon something, or sort of funny interactions that happened with them around having seen a piece on the street. And it has a way of changing the way that I see the city by changing the way that I'm looking at people and architecture and thinking about the way that people inhabit the city and the way that we move through it. And I've also, you know, heard a lot of kind of amazing stories just about people who talk about discovering graffiti and discovering street art and how it changed the way that they thought about the city as well. And so it's one of those things that, you know, as I've grown as an artist and changed and done lots and lots of different kinds of projects, I really struggled with a lot of different thought processes and a lot of mediums. This is like the backbone of what I do, you know, drawing portraits and pasting them up outside as this body of work that I imagine will probably carry through the rest of my life in some form or another. And, you know, for me, the portrait is kind of, it's just like this kind of basic sort of, I don't know, expression of human beings and of our lives, and so I over try to do it over and over again. And the longer I draw, I find that I get sort of deeper and deeper into the psychology of the drawing and into what you can evoke through a portrait. Here's a little process shot of the paper cuts, which is where I start with the drawing and then cut it out with a knife, and then you peel away the top layer and you get that kind of clean image. And so this is a drawing of my father. And so yeah, the longer I make drawings, the more I sort of get pulled into this feeling of trying to really like pull a human presence like through the eye of the needle and trying to communicate something really intensely with people in spaces that they're not necessarily expecting to find them, as Carrie mentioned. I think that there's something disarming about showing up in, you know, just like just on a city street, or just like, you know, popping up in someone's path, or a lot of times in sort of neglected city spaces, and showing that kind of care. I always think, like, people talk about graffiti, I talk about broken windows theory, and I kind of have an opposite view of it. Maybe it's idealistic of me, but I feel that I'm giving so much care to that place, and that it's this way of expressing, like, a deep amount of love and a deep amount of involvement in our cities. And I imagine, you know, that for me, when I put a work up outside, it's a lot about sort of opening that space up for discussion. So, oh, there's a drawing of Ben. Hi, Ben. I always feel like I'm trying to create a more participatory environment within which people feel welcome to be a part of the creation of the sort of visual fabric of our cities. And, you know, thinking a lot about the concept of a visual public domain, that in, you know, sort of our questions about democracy and how do we participate in our lives and how do we participate in the creation of our cities, that the feeling that, you know, it's not just about kind of advertising and these sort of like slick kind of corporate buttoned down like image of our lives, it's also to the creation of kinds of city spaces that we have participated in and that the human touches on and that people feel that they can, like, a little bit of time be a part of. And so as, you know, I was working outside and, you know, it's when you're working outside and you're pasting up and you kind of know that you're doing this illegal thing, you're like, okay, the space isn't mine and whose is it and why? And it's really opened up a lot of questions for me about participation in cities and about, you know, just the democratization of our spaces and whose spaces they were and why, and a so I, you know, started to which I think is a good idea at any stage in your life, I sort of got together with a group of friends and just decided to make some things that really, like, push some of those questions further. And so we, you know, our collective was called Toyshop, and we were just a lot about kind of, like, fun, ridiculous, adventurous kinds of moments. And there was, that was a picture of us changing our lives in the subway. And here is a moment where we took a big roll of paper to the park and had kids draw all over it, and then we inserted those drawings into billboard spaces. You know, and part of that I thought with this action was, you know, I had been pacing up for a long time and thinking a lot about how I wasn't just interested in showing my work and being like, okay, here I am, this is what I'm doing, but I wanted to sort of declare those spaces as open spaces. And so one way that felt, like, powerful to do that was to take kids' drawings and to put them outside, because everyone recognizes that and everyone identifies with that and everyone kind of knows, like, who those people are, and so to really, you know, just, like, to get that, you understand that. And so to put those into the advertising spaces just felt like a really nice way to take them over and to kind of make that a two-way street. And this is a kind of a silly event that we did called Pirates of the Staten Island Ferry. There's a ferry that goes every day from Manhattan to Staten Island, and it's free. And there was just this sort of ridiculous moment where we were like, oh, we're going to dress up as pirates, and they're like, ah, it's taking this ferry to get to Staten Island, we roam from. We're dancing and making computers, like, get drunk and listen to accordion with us. And, you know, just, like, always, like, thinking about how to take the sort of, like, buttoned up, like, everyday sort of, like, stuffy city life and just try to, like, make it a bit more obvious and a bit more fun. We also did a jump band where we took, like, hundreds of instruments made out of garbage and we paraded down Houston Street and called people out of their sort of bars and ridiculousness. And you know, during this whole period of time, this is a bad little match that happened in the street. And this was you guys know Walter Benjamin's Earth Room. It's a permanent installation that exists in Manhattan, and it's a room full of mud, and I'm not supposed to touch it or take pictures of it. And one thing that I really, 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 really wanted to do was mud wrestle in it. And so that was one of the last actions of our collective, was to have a great mud wrestle. I was like, there's this way to, like, really interact with this thing, but you know that once you move, it's fine, and you just break the dirt back over. You know, you were kind of, like, supremely, what's the word? Well, anyway, just indulgent without it. So during that period, you know, I started to think more and more about, you know, my drawings were developing further, and I was thinking more and more about what if I took the drawings that I had been making and had been putting outside on the street and started to kind of expand that thinking into rooms that you could walk around in. You know, I've been making lots of drawings where you can see that there's, like, a portrait, but then there's this, like, kind of psychological x-ray, or sort of temporal x-ray of all the things that you can see inside the figure, and sort of what they're thinking about and what they've been through. And so I wanted to then expand that thinking even further and create that as a space that not only did your eye move through, but that your body can move through, and that you can sort of walk through the way that your eye moves through a drawing. And, you know, that sort of coincided with the time that people started inviting me to work inside. And as somebody who had pretty much always been, you know, ever since I myself developed as an artist, as somebody who had always been working inside, it was a bit intimidating, and I definitely had all that kind of internal struggle of, like, am I selling out? Is this, like, am I becoming trapped? Like, how much will I change? Will my work, you know, lose its vitality? Will I, you know, just sort of get back into all of the kind of traps that were the thing that I felt I was becoming independent from when I first started to work outside? And, you know, the answer is in some ways yes and in some ways no. But mostly for me, I found that once I had created a context outside within which to work, and once I understood that no matter who you were and no matter what means were at your disposal, that you could create your own world and you could create your own vision artistically, and that you didn't sort of need approval and you didn't need permission and you didn't need to wait for anyone, but you could just do it. And once I sort of understood that and had that and had kind of embodied that, it didn't feel like quite so intimidating for me to then accept invitations and to work in institutions, because I understood them as just kind of a setting, you know, one possible place within which to work. And you get a lot of time and a lot of space to really play out your ideas. And so I've spent the last few years, kind of every few months, I will work on the creation of an installation with lots of different materials, and I often collaborate with people. This is those images that I showed you of Toyshop Collective. This was us coming together again and working on an installation indoors. And, you know, working collaboratively with people on installations is always, like, is so crazily difficult. You know, are struggling with someone else's thought process and your own thought process. And I love to do it so much because that kind of challenge to your own thought process for me is one of the best ways to grow. This is an installation I did with a friend, Monica Kenneloff, I often work with. She's an amazing artist in San Francisco. And, you know, you're just working with people and they just do things that you never would imagine. And just sort of being in their presence while they're creating that and having what they're creating overlap with what you're creating is a really immense and awesome thing. And so I try to do it whenever I can. And this is a picture which is my first kind of major installation with a gallery in New York called Dice Projects. And this was definitely one of those pivotal moments for me when I could really feel that kind of the establishment was calling. You know, this was a person who was like really well known for supporting large projects and, you know, and my decision to work with him or not was very terrifying. And then once I did, it was this amazing experience where I just found that being given that kind of space to work in and that kind of time to work in. And it was the first time that I ever had a crew to work on an installation, which is such an amazing gift. And also it's just something that you have to learn. It's like becoming a construction boss versus like, you know, being this kind of like quiet studio artist. And so it really broke my head open once again. But I was able to then, you know, just like feel my thinking expand and sort of feel that like kind of next level of energy happen. But then while I was doing that, I feel like I also kind of made a deal with myself. I was like, okay, if I do this thing, which is this kind of like clearly very institutional, sort of official, like scary thing, then I'm also just going to give myself like the chance to do something that I've always been dreaming of doing and something kind of crazy afterwards. And so, so what I did was organize a group of people to build rafts and go down the Mississippi River. And that was one of those things where for about 5 years I had been going like, hey guys, we're going to build this boat, right? Yeah, let's build a boat, let's go down the river. And people were like, yeah, right, you're going to die. People were like, oh, I'm drowning. And I just sort of kept talking about it. And I think also like as you guys are developing your ideas and as you're thinking about things, like don't beat yourself up too much if it doesn't happen right away. Like of course, like give yourself like all the gung-ho to like realize things. But I find that sometimes, you know, ideas start as seeds and those seeds open up really slowly. And sometimes, and listen, we just have to kind of talk shit about something for 5 years before it finally happens. You know, I just have to like blah, 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 blah. You know, and then things start to come together. And you really like, as you put those ideas out and as you talk to people about them more and people who are interested in that and feel connected with it start to bring you things and go like, hey, what about this? And have you heard of the floating neutrinos? And what about the Mississippi River? And what about these guys in Minneapolis that do this every year? And so that was the sort of thing that happened. And then there was a moment finally in that where I kind of felt a window opening and I started to reach out to people and instead of saying like, no, you're gonna drown, they were like, you know what, yeah, I think that makes sense. Like, I don't have anything really challenging to work on right now, let's do this. And so I got together a group of collaborators and we started making plans and sketches. We linked up with a woman who was from a group called the Floating Neutrinos. This is funny. Scale models are bad, people got a lot of problems. And we held fundraisers and got together a crew and took it on the road. And we made a real leap of faith. We left with all of our stuff packed up on the back of our truck before we even had a build site. So the Floating Neutrinos had scrap wrapped in transatlantic and they showed us this design. And so, you know, the thought for me at the time was to create something that, you know, basically I was thinking a lot about the situation of our lives and of our kind of crazy consumptive lifestyle. And it was right about the time that the war in Iraq was starting. And I really felt like I wanted to create something that traveled throughout the country, both for me to kind of understand, like, who are Americans, like, what does it mean to be American, and to try and just communicate with people some of the thoughts and feelings that we were having about trying to not leave such a crazy consumptive lifestyle that we were waging wars and that, and just sort of all the things that myself and my community of artists were doing to try and figure out how to live and how to live communally and how to live with lower impact and how to make art and how to just have a soulful existence. I wanted to create like a little vessel that could kind of hold all of those things in music and culture and experimentation and all of those things and to then travel down the river and meet people. So this guy was building his yard. And so we collected lots of materials from construction sites all around New York City. And in Minneapolis, we used styrofoam that was used in shipping. We even developed our own motors because we ran into them on Friday, so we couldn't afford motors. So we just connected with every person that we knew who had been kind of living that like super DIY, figure things out yourself lifestyle. And we just like, you know, posse up and started this trip. And it was incredible. We went for 2 years. First we went from Minneapolis to St. Louis, and then from St. Louis to the Quad Cities. And this night was the night that we first launched our rafts. And I say this a lot, but it was one of the most incredible nights of my life. Just this feeling of having to create these vessels, and then test driving them and feeling them just kind of like spin out. Yeah, catching them over. Feeling them spin out over the water. You know that it was floating and that you had made it. And you know, we were bringing all these kind of insane things. Here's a Ferris wheel that my friend Paula Plumber had made, and these speakers from the Barnstormers. And we just wanted to be like this kind of, you know, Noah's Ark of everything that we loved. And we were so absurd that the way that people responded to it was really incredible. I've never, you know, to this day, kind of never had an experience like that where the response from people was so pure. And they would just be like, what are you? It's like, we're a boat, I don't know. And people would bring us, you know, warm socks and like home cooked meals. And of course, I called the police like a million times when we were out of town also. But there was just this kind of like, first there would be a lot of fear, like, what are you guys doing? You know, what's going on? But that almost always gave way into this kind of like real wonderment. And we would do performances because, you know, our performances were really, really, really terrible. But the nice thing about doing a performance is that all those questions that people have, like, who are you? What are you? Why are you doing this? How does this all work? It's a really nice way to be like, come at six, we're gonna play some really bad songs, play some really bad jokes, and like, then it'll all make sense. And it's like, just this way of kind of introducing that it is, I don't know, sort of special. So we do performances down the river, and the Mississippi River is just an unbelievable place. And we did it for 2 years. The second year was, you know, a bit hairier. We became a new group, which was awesome and fun, but it also meant that, like, we just, our impact was a lot more sporadic, and we kind of got a lot more of a reputation for being, like, sort of crazy, thieving, marauding, looting people. But in the end, it was a really wonderful experience. And there's a guy who just passed away recently, actually. His name is Bob Castle, and he's a visionary that you guys should check out. He built the City Museum of St. Louis, and he let us dock our boats on his land while we were wintering them, and they ended up, because that land was publicly accessible, the boats were burned down and covered from shore. So, you know, we wanted very much to not be kind of a horribly ecological impact. We wanted to sort of be a laboratory of good things, but there were, you know, there were definitely some tragedies in that, and I would say that, like, setting free, like, burning hunks of styrofoam down the Mississippi River is one thing I regret, but otherwise it was really wonderful and amazing, and taught me so much. And so, you know, following on the heels of this, I'm kind of always like snaking through different thought processes. And so I had spent these 2 years on the river making boats and living collectively, and it being like this really like an experiment of communal living, and that sort of difficulty that is of living like on a raft with 25 of your favorite people and trying to make consensus decisions and trying to, like, you know, just like live in a certain way, which is amazing, but which is also really trying, and for which sometimes like the aesthetic drives and sort of creative visions tend to get kind of sucked under. And so I wanted to take a lot of things that I knew about boat building and bring it back into kind of a more aesthetic thought process. And actually, can I ask how long I have wanted to talk? Because I think I'm getting a little wild. Okay, then I'll just keep going. So here's a little scale model that I made of a raft that I imagined as kind of a hybrid of the mangrove swamps. From down where my dad lives in Florida, and sort of various cities, I imagined these vessels that, in my mind, were a bit like bits of kind of fantastical cities. You know, all the different various cities that I've been to in the world, like Varanasi and Bangkok, and just different places which really feel amazing to me in Venice. And then I imagined as though they sort of like bits of these land masses kind of broke off and went out to sea and developed their own like strange life on the water. And so it ended up to be kind of this. Adventure ended up to be a lot more like the Rockaway than I realized it was going to be, just because, you know, by the time you have this kind of like community of people that have all this knowledge in boat building and in performing, it ends up to, you know, the thought process has evolved. And actually, the person who first invited me here, Bill Rice, who went to FSU, he's in India right now, with some of the same people. Yeah! Wish it luck! With some of the same people who have worked with me since the Rockaway and on the Swimming Cities project. And they decided to go on. I was like, never again, at least not right now, am I going to lose my journal in the river. Like, I'm tired of floating problems. I want other kinds of problems. And so I like passed the torch, and those guys are carrying on, and I'm really excited for them. But so here we were. We were coming down Hudson River, and this is where I met my love. Hi, Ben. And we were coming down the Hudson River, and my friend was a playwright. This is DeMore, wrote a play. And I made an installation which these boats were traveling towards. And so there was this kind of this narrative of these boats which started in Troy and which made their way down the Hudson River to this installation which was waiting for them. And so this, you know, at this moment in my life was my way of bringing together kind of everything that I had learned and synthesizing it into one sort of massive endeavor. We are going in under the, yes, this was kind of incredible. So you can see what life was like here. It's like the most fun and kind of like the most miserable day of your life all together, all at the same time. Really stranded, right? And we rounded the tip of Manhattan, which, like, you can imagine my vessels, like, this was quite exciting. And of course, like, you know how I was saying in the Mississippi, people were still like, oh my gosh, where are you? Where are you? And people were so excited. And if you can see in the background, there's the Staten Island Ferry. And as we got past them, I was like, wait, like, hey guys, hey! Nobody waved at us at all. Just somebody like raised their cell phone and called. And he got pulled over. Like, oh my god, we're getting pulled over. And she just said, I and they were like, thought you guys were doing pirates. Like, really? Come on now. But so this was the installation that connected back to. And I have to say, after this, I've never been more tired in my whole entire life. You know how, like, when you're done with a project and you're just, like, bone tired and you don't dream anymore and you don't, there's nothing, just nothing. That's why I don't do this. But here were the sisters, and they were all these ropes, we're kind of waiting to embrace them. And so the sort of backstory of those boats is that really, they were inspired by Venice, which the first time that I ever approached Venice, it was by water, and it was this kind of crazy, fantastical city rising up out of the ocean. And I was like, one day I'm going to make something which is a proper homage to this place. So we did it again. We got together a crew, and this time we started in Slovenia, which is where all the Tid River Venice was taken. We just sort of wanted to have a voyage, and so we ended up skirting the coast and going into the Adriatic Sea, which was quite incredible. As you can imagine, again, that feeling of like driving your own kind of homemade piece of garbage in the middle of this beautiful sea is very, very, very surreal and powerful and terrifying. Usually the seas were calm like this. Sometimes they would get really intense. We had to be saved by some fishermen from the Bora, which are these winds that come in off the Alps, and we would lash up and have lunch. Just be this kind of crazy island. Like, a couple times we sort of just like docked out and stayed out in the lagoon and just sort of had this feeling of literally having created your own world and your own land. So we would cook on board and live on board and drive back the trigger. Sometimes we would go through the canals in Italy and make our way towards Venice. Yeah, they pulled us over a lot too. Which, you know, it turns out that in Europe we never could have gotten away with this, but because we had started in the United States, and the boats are registered, you can see there's like a whole number. Yeah, no, it's their license plate. So because they were registered in the United States, they had to respect the maritime law of the United States. So they weren't very happy about it, but they did it. This is sort of a ridiculous moment. The girl was like making out here in the corner of the boat. She was one of the captains, and at a certain point they tried to block us from coming into Venice, and they were like, what are you doing? We have our own laws here. You can't come. And so her solution to this, like, usually she was very diplomatic, and she'd give people a beer and try to sit them down and talk to them, but this time she just rammed the boat. She just took, like, her little, like, vessel and just rammed into them and was like, we're coming! It's fine! And, like, so that worked. So I guess the lesson there is, like, just try various tactics. You never know what's going to get you by. So we would have performances. And, you know, Venice is such a magical place that being there and performing was was really incredible. And, you know, we were there during the Biennale, which, like, was really fun, but for me it was also, like, a little bit funny because I was, like, you know, my feeling was basically about making an homage to Venice, and I felt a little bit embarrassed, like, being like, oh, hey, Biennale, but it was just sort of worked out that way that was where we went, and it was fun to be there at that time, but my real hope was to connect with people who lived in Venice, because I felt like these are people that know beautiful boats and cities and have these kinds of, like, dreams just in, you know, in their daily lives. And in fact, some guy at this performance came forward to me, and he said, he was like, you know, in very romantic Italian fashion, he was like, Venice is a city of a thousand dreamers, but in Venice, you see a dream such as this. And that's when I learned the other thing that I want to share with you guys, which is that sometimes people tell you no only because they don't want to be the person that told you yes. But that doesn't mean they're going to stop you. That doesn't mean you should do it. So it was definitely like the most beautiful 3 hours of my life. And I'm just saying that, but really it was incredible. I was almost in tears. And I'm going to see if this works. I'm going to try to plan a little movie of my dad. and talk about the, another sort of thought process, which is carried through a lot of my work, and that is how to, you know, be kind of directly involved in some of the things which concern me really deeply, and how to have work which, or how to make work which has an impact on the world in different ways. And so this project was a project actually organized by a stencil artist named Bansi, and he took a group of people to Palestine, and we made work on the wall that that separates Israel and Palestine, the apartheid wall. And you know, one of the, it was an interesting project because there were various opinions, and you know, for the most part, people would be like, "Oh, this is amazing! Thank you for doing this." But I did speak to one guy that worked in the one of the camps, like right on the other side of the wall, and he was like, "You know, this is great. We love what you guys are doing here, but you're bringing all this color and all this light to this wall, and the kids love you guys and they want to hang out there, and we never want them to have a positive association with this. We want this to be taken down. We don't ever want for this to be celebrated in any way." And it was just an interesting perspective. I think like a lot of the things, you know, that I am just thinking about how, you know, as artists, do you make things that are important? And for me, one of the things that was nice about working on this wall was, you know, images like this one's really tiny, but you can see the scale of it. That sometimes in pictures, when it was just a plain kind of wall, you couldn't really tell necessarily how massively huge it was. But once people started to make marks on it, not only did you get that feeling of like trying to have a bit of just sort of offer something to people who were living trapped on the other side of it, but also to just sort of show the world the scale of something like that. And so that was an intervention which I think was interesting in certain ways, and I ended up making a drawing. There's some kids that live in one of the camps that's on the other side of the wall. And so for me, the question is, you know, my background is as a fine artist and is in drawing, and so usually that's like my initial response to something, is to try and understand a story and to make a drawing about it. And this is another situation that, I don't know how much you guys know about what's going on in Ciudad Juarez right now. I know that it's like, it's kind of much, has sort of expanded to be much more horrible than even it was. I was going through Mexico overland about 5 years ago, and I started to see these little crosses in Ciudad Juarez right over the border. These little crosses painted on telephone poles. And as somebody who's always looking at what's painted on the walls and being like, "Hey, what is that trying to communicate? What is that for?" I started to ask, like, "Hey, what is this about?" And people started to say, "Oh, that's for the women that have been killed." And I was really shocked to myself at the time that it wasn't something that I knew anything about. And so it felt to me like something that I wanted to try and understand more of and to maybe create a drawing on that subject. And so with a friend of mine, Tennessee Watson, who is a documentarian and does a lot of work in Mexico, I went back down to Juarez a couple of years ago, and worked with an activist organization started by a teacher who lost one of her students, and it's called That Our Daughters May Return Home. And they do all kinds of different work from they do like lots of workshops and things with children who have lost their mothers, and they also do Press for Justice, and they're just sort of working in all different aspects of the struggle to try and figure out why these murders are happening and to try to stop them in this really terrifying situation. And so, you know, we met a lot of the women who are fighting against the situation. We learned about the work that they're doing. We learned about the resistance that is against them. As you can see, they put up a memorial crosses and they've been knocked down. And I met this woman named Ramona, whose daughter, Sylvia Elena, was one of the first women to be killed in 1996. And we spoke with a lot of different women and talked, you know, about the work that they're doing and about their struggles and about what it was like for them to lose their daughters, and made audio recordings. And just tried to learn as much as we could about their lives. And then I made a drawing, which is of Sylvia Elena, and have done a few installations of it in various places, although I haven't actually been back to Mexico yet. I'm just going to send this drawing out soon. What you can see here is there's a lot of butterflies kind of hanging. And the butterflies, the monarch is said to carry the souls of the dead. And a lot of women are killed when they're, like, there's a lot of young girls who are killed when they're teenagers. And the last photo that they have of them is in a quinceañera when they're, like, 15, and it's kind of sweet 16. So I drew her kind of still in her quinceañera dress. And in the butterflies, there's little headphones, and you can pick up the headphones and hear the stories being told by Ramona and other women that we interviewed. And, you know, it's such an intense situation that I'm actually going to not say too much about it, because I think, you know, if people want to learn about it, like, definitely research and see if there's any way that you can become involved. Speak about, so there's this thinking about, you know, making drawings and sort of how, what impact that has and how you can communicate. But sort of as always in my work, I find that I feel like pressed up against the limitations of any medium, and always wanting to try to find different ways to interact and to try and, I guess for lack of a better word, to help. And so this is a project called Coffee Shelter, and Ben and I, Ben is here, were at a cabin in the woods studying architecture when the news of the earthquake in Haiti hit. And Ben was really inspired to try and go down there right away and try and help. And for me, that was one of those moments where I never would have thought of myself as somebody who could be like, oh, I can be involved in this. I can go down and try and help this situation. But Ben having like such an intense passion to want to go and to want to help and feeling like he had some skills to lend really just sort of made me feel like, okay, this, you know, this does make sense. This does feel like that you don't always have to bottle up the desire to be helpful, to be involved, and you don't always have to be scared. Like sometimes you can just sort of be like, okay, let's think this through. And so, you know, we realized right away that we weren't going to be first responders and that we didn't, you know, speak Creole or have any medical skills, and that it was sort of what would be wise for us would be to develop a project and to sort of research and figure out how we could help. And so since we were, you know, artists and builders, and since we're sort of learning about architecture, we decided to develop a project where we borrowed a style, which was a vintage. There's an Iranian architect named Nader Khalili, and he spent the last like 20 years of his life working on the problem of affordable housing and working on the problem of disaster housing. And, you know, he had been kind of a mainstream architect who then decided to take the language of his native Iran, the Adobe language of architecture, and try to turn it into something even more permanent and develop it in sort of a more modern way. And so, you know, this was one of those situations where we knew that we weren't going to reinvent the wheel, and we decided that to learn something and to then share it would be the best thing that we could do. And so we went to Haiti, sort of on a research mission, to try and see, did our hunch really make sense? Would something like this really be useful in post-earthquake Haiti? And to try and see if the materials and resources were there, and to see if that we could find a partner to work with. And we shortly, after traveling, we found there's a group, the Mango Growers Association, in a small village outside of Léogane in Comier, and we talked to them about our idea, and they said, yeah, let's, you know, let's do this. People, there's a lot of small houses out in the countryside that have been destroyed. There's a lot of people who need work. People need, you know, even people just need things to do in the aftermath to sort of psychologically process what's been going on. And, you know, everything, we had gone and talked to a lot of different people, a lot of architects and a lot of builders about this idea, and everyone said, you know, if you're going to introduce something new and something that's unfamiliar to people, you should really start with a public structure. You know, even in a situation where people need housing, no one wants to be the one person with the weird house. You have to make something that people feel is, maybe it's a school, it's a community center, that everyone can get their hands on, that people can be involved in, and then they can decide together, like, okay, do you like this? Does this work for us? And so it was kind of this amazing fit where we found the Mango Growers, and they said, yeah, we've been wanting a community center for a long time. We do adult literacy classes, and, you know, sometimes people want to do that privately. And there's just various reasons why we want a center to meet. And so it seemed like a really good place to start. And so we found this village and look at these amazing little guys. and, you know, it sort of, we quickly realized that it was a houses, And so they then brought up some of their demolished houses and we used it as backfill for the gentleman's circulator, you can see, and a bunch of the guys that later became really expert builders. They really, you know, as I think is to be expected, within a few weeks, they were way, way, way better at this than we kind of ever were. And so we ended up to, it was just awesome, like watching that learning curve and sort of realizing very quickly how, you know, just kind of like, I don't know how to say it, being humbled. And so it took us about 6 weeks. It was really intense hard work. And we built a community center and worked with a lot of artisans, which was really beautiful and lucky to be able to sort of see the craft that people have just to have this team that was this one village, and everyone in the village kind of had grown up together and knew each other their whole lives, and it was really amazing for them to be accepting of us. There was a baby that was born during the build, it's messy, and this is a window that had been made out of 55-gallon drums, and it was just a lot of learning and a lot of experimentation on our part. And it was one of those things where a lot of people said, like, you guys are artists, you're not builders, you're not medics, like, why are you doing this? Why don't you leave this to the NGOs, like, people who know what they're doing, you can cut more harm than good. And, you know, I feel like I just kept those questions, like, really, I just sort of put them in my belly and put them in my mind and held on to them and kept them in mind, but didn't let them stop what I felt was possibly going to be a really amazing and positive experience, which I think was. And so, you know, it was sort of one of those moments of taking a chance and knowing that you have as much to learn from a situation as you have to give, and just trying to, like, sort of take, you know, I think what Carrie Ann did when she connected the homeless shelter with grad students is another example of this. If you sort of take two sets of needs, you know, you have these students that want to get out of the world, need to learn things, people need to feel connected with, you know, this desire to help and this desire to make change. And, like, that's a super strong drive in all of us, and I feel like we need to find an outlet for that. And so, you know, she sort of identified all this energy here and then saw this shelter that was like, hey, wait a minute, this yard's been totally neglected, they've lost their funding, people are sleeping outside. And she just sort of did this magic trick of connecting the dots and saying, like, yeah, I think you made something special here. And so, I don't know, that's something that I have been thinking about a lot lately and working with. Here's Betsy, she's bigger now. So we went back and we built a house as well. So the first year we built a community center, and then we ended up being lucky enough to receive a Rockefeller Foundation grant on Creative Time, and we went back and built a house. And here's the house with some modifications in the design. And, oh, sorry, my slides were a little out of order, so it's back and forth. So here's the community center again. And here's the opening day of the community center. I have some friends, my friend Naima, who's a performer and who is Haitian. Her grandfather is Haitian. She went back with another group, and we ended up being, you know, another one of those moments of feeling the importance of your community and of connecting with friends. Because she was having a hard time sort of understanding, like, knowing she wanted to go back to Haiti and visit, you know, her kind of like family's home country, and she wanted to help, but not quite knowing, like, how to connect the dots. And so we were able to, you know, we built the community center, but we weren't really able to engage in any programming or any of the kind of fun things that could be a part of it. So then she kind of stepped in and was able to throw a party with people and open the community center. And that was really amazing. And yeah, like I said, working with the past people there was really super amazing and learning, just watching people, these amazing windows, and you know, and like I said, I just feel really lucky to be able to have engaged in this process of having, you know, having these ideas and seeing buildings get built and being a part of the creation of them. And right now we're in the process of trying to, it's been about a year, and we're starting to just ask people, like, okay, it's been a year, what do you think about the structures? Do they work? Do you like them? Do they leak? Do you use them? Do people feel comfortable with them? You know, what's next? Should we come back? And mostly we're hearing, yes, definitely come back. And I think we're going to try and figure out, like, what the next steps are and how to sort of try to create something which is an opportunity for people there, but sort of turns the project over. This is a project that I just got back from doing in Sao Paulo, and it's actually fairly related to what we're doing here at the homeless shelter, in that I built with a group of friends, I built an encampment on this plaza in Sao Paulo. And, you know, I really wanted to create something that could be a shelter for people, because there's a lot of people that live outside of Sao Paulo, but at the same time I felt really intimidated, and that we didn't have, like, necessarily a structure of social workers, and I didn't want to create something that people could be evicted from. But we decided to sort of just still try and create something that could be a house for a lot of different ideas. And so we got in touch with a lot of different groups, like the Cazadores. They're groups of recyclers. They go all over the city collecting recyclables. You see this is a cart that one of the guys has painted. We got in touch with those guys. We got in touch with all different kinds of community organizations. And we just said, like, if you had a platform on one of the main plazas in Sao Paulo, like, what would you use it for? How would you envision it? And so then we created the space, and people are hosting workshops and doing various events. Some gardeners came through. And some of the amazing things that are happening from the project are, one, people have actually moved into it after all. And two, there's various, like, a lot of the groups that we worked with have then started to sort of cross-pollinate and work with each other. And so this was an interesting project. I ended up collaborating with a lawyer and a community organizer, and so she really had this whole language of how to connect to people, and how people work together, and how grassroots movements build themselves, and all these things that I was less versed in, because I spent so much time just kind of cutting and pasting and drawing and being a little bit isolated. And so that was a really amazing and interesting learning experience, and it's still happening, it's still there actually, so I'm sure there will be more stories. And I just want to close, I'm almost done, I have a few more projects I want to talk about. So outside of Pittsburgh, in a town called Braddock, Pennsylvania, with a group of people, a lot of the people actually who were in Toyshop, that collective, ages and ages ago, it's important to stick together with your friends. We own on a conditional deed, we own an old church and a lot right next to it, and we are working slowly to turn the church into, right now, probably kind of an arts-based community center, although the idea is really open for change and interpretation. But we're going to basically take this old building and turn it into something which is going to be of various uses for our community of artists and the community there in Braddock, and to try and find ways to bring people together. And one cool thing that happened was, in the lot, we were able to actually prototype our first dome for Haiti. So it's been an interesting space of, like, a laboratory for developing ideas, and it's something that's going to continue happening in the future. So if anyone has any, I don't know if people are ever driving through there, or if you have any sort of thoughts or ideas for being involved in projects in the future, that's something that will be going on for a long, long, long term, you know, 20, 30 years down the line. And another project that I've started that I want to invite people to just be aware of and participate in, perhaps, is the creation of a musical house in New Orleans. So with another group of friends, I will soon be creating this kind of, like, funny gingerbread sort of Victorian house, but we just now in New Orleans started to develop a lot of instrumentation. Unfortunately, I don't have any videos of it or anything, but a whole bunch of sound artists all got together and built a whole village with various instruments inside, and that was the prototype for the instruments that will go into this house. And so you'll have, kind of, as the doors and windows open, they'll be playing various instruments and floorboards you can step on, and part cabinets in the walls that can sort of turn and make noises. And I think this is another thing where I find myself kind of always going back and forth between, like, kind of heavy, serious endeavors and sort of whimsical, fun, you know, endeavors that kind of just re-center me, like, with the joy of life, and kind of don't let things get too heavy. And I think after Haiti, I definitely needed a break and needed some time just, like, in my studio and create sort of quietly. And so I accepted a series of projects to make kind of large sculptures and museums, which, you know, it's one of those things where there's things that are wonderful about it and things that are negative about it. But I definitely have really enjoyed being able to spend the last year just kind of drawing. And so I started this series of epic, large, sort of oversized prints and then turning them into sculptures. So this is one of the last projects that I did. It's a sculpture of the deity Talasa, which is an incarnation of the sea. And at the time, I was thinking a lot about the spill of the Gulf, and just sort of mourning a lot the fact that that had happened, and, you know, and just having grown up on the ocean and sort of having that lifelong connection to the sea, I needed to make something which, in my own kind of private way, spoke about that, but which also really celebrated the sea. So that's all. Okay, so the question was how to dig into ideas and develop them and keep the momentum going. I have to be honest that right now I've been going so fast that I have like lost touch with developing ideas. It's kind of a problem and I need to take a break. But I think that that's a good question. The first thing that I do is, you know, you get an idea, and honestly, the first thing that I do is start talking about it with people. I share it, and through sharing it, you sort of hear it reflected back to you. I write it down and make sketches, and the other thing I do is research about it. You know, I'll get like, oh, okay, I have this idea, and then I'll like go to the library and collect every book I can think of on the subject, and get books on tape about, you know, anything related to it, sort of listen to it while I'm carving, and just try to like kind of make little connections happen and bring together anything that I can feel, because I guess, you know, it feels like a bit of alchemy of like how do you take inert matter and an idea and bring it together and create something that is alive. And so it just feels like starting with a snowball and then just like creeping it downhill. Anyone else? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I was talking about how when I couldn't afford big linoleum and I wanted to make these life-size drawings, I came upon the idea of just cutting up sheets of paper because that's cheap, you can afford that. And so I always think that that's like kind of a good moment for me to remember, because it's so often that we find ourselves being like, oh, I don't have the funding, or I don't, I just get this thing. And the truth is, you don't need that. Whatever you think you need, you don't need it. Just do something else, it'll get you there. It's really about the idea, and it's really about just making it happen and what you learn from it. Yes?
So, how do you deal with all these things that are crazy?
Yeah, I have a really cluttered life. my boats are in a shipping container in Italy right now. Like my friend's town, he's like bribing the guy at the dock to like not charge me too much rent for them. I don't deal with it that well. I make all this big stuff and then I'm like, I don't know what to do with this stuff. Yes.
Have you or would you use a laser cutter? And do you feel like people that use laser cutters for paper prints are cheating or copying out of handmade work?
Okay, so the question is the laser cutter. So I used to be kind of a purist about the laser cutter, and then I'm 33 years old and my arm barely functions anymore. So I'm kind of over that now. And I pretty much cut by hand, you know, 99% of the time, but I also have a lot of people who help me make the duplicates. And I worry about their hands too, you know. It's like really great and lucky to have assistants, but it's also like, you know, I'm starting to have worked with people for a long enough time that I'm like, oh, maybe you're gonna start having the same problems I do. And so I recently, for an animation, oh, I should have showed you guys that animation. Anyway, my friend Pat Solon made this animation of a piece that I did in Los Angeles, and she introduced me to the laser cutter, and I actually think it's kind of rad. So I'm not a purist about that at all. Particularly when it comes to, like, you know, cutting a trillion, thousand, billion things and injuring yourself. It's like, don't be a martyr, you know? Yes? So the question is about advice for people when you encounter challenges. I'm trying to think of the best way that I sort of deal with like difficulty. Okay, this is dumb. Go out behind a van in the woods somewhere and cry. That's like what I usually do. I find someone just to hide and just cry for a little while. Find somebody to cry with sometimes, sometimes not. That's like a good thing to do. But I do pretty much every project. And I would say the other thing is just to get enough alone time and surround yourself with positive people and positive ideas and, you know, books and songs and things that just like take you back to a really simple reminder of what it is that you're doing and why. And like just don't forget to sort of give yourself that. And don't forget that it serves something about how all that stuff about doubt is like just, it's just more hurdles, and that it's really natural for the world to doubt you and for you to doubt yourself when you're doing something that hasn't been done before. It's like you're like, oh, I want to do this. People will be like, oh, you can't do that. And of course they're saying you can't do that. They haven't seen it happen before. But that's all the more reason to do it, you know? So, yes.
When you get up and go to different locations, what do you leave behind and what do you look forward to coming back to when you're done?
Okay, so the sort of process of constantly leaving something behind and wait, what do I come back to when I'm done?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think that, you know, most places that I go, because I'm traveling all the time, I'm kind of constantly looking to each place as a source of inspiration. And so, you know, sometimes that's really literal, like I'm just documenting and meeting people and sort of researching for drawings, and sometimes it's a little bit more esoteric, but, and then, you know, I also, sometimes what I leave behind is like quite concrete, sometimes it's like a bunch of street posters, or, you know, conversations that I've had, but usually it's, you know, some kind of bit of, you know, trying to make that place a little bit better in the only way that I know how, which is sort of through the work. I guess that's it. I feel like sometimes I get a little lost on questions. That was going to be the other thing I was going to answer right away. She asked why Swoon. So when I was in college and I was doing those billboards that I showed you, it actually turned out that those billboards were illegal, but I didn't realize that, and I was like, oh gosh, I'm doing all these totally illegal things. And I had seen this, I had been doing a lot of different types of things out on the street, and I never signed any of it. And then I saw this one artist named Bast, who would do lots of different things but signed it, and so you could tell that it was connected. And, you know, at first I was like, oh, that's ego to have your name and whatever, but then actually when I saw him do that, I was like, oh, I actually really appreciate seeing that thought process morph and change and being able to kind of like hear the voice of that person as they like learn and grow and do different stuff outside. And so I just was kind of went over to it. I was like, that's kind of neat to sort of attach a moniker to something and just be like, hi. And so I decided that I wanted a name, and I remembered that my boyfriend at the time was often a collaborator of mine, had this dream that I was a graffiti artist who wrote Swoon. And it was at a time when I was like, that is totally ridiculous, I would never do that. But like, when I remembered it later, I was like, oh, a beautiful word, and like, oh, maybe, okay, yeah, maybe this makes sense. So, anyway. Okay, yes?
What are your thoughts on life? The magnum?
Yeah, that's a good question. He asked about magnum opus. I mean, definitely there are moments, like the time when I was sort of talking about the boats and being like, you know, I could barely think straight after that. Like, I think that there are like milestones of that, where you feel like, okay, this is my magnum opus for the moment. Another thing that happens is I'll make a series of drawings, and I would say like one out of three, there's just something good about it. It just sort of works, and it just like, feel that it's like drawing out everything that you have, and it, like, and the other two are like maybe just kind of weird, they didn't work out so well, what are you gonna do? But like, I think that I have like my little sort of milestones of that, and then I haven't quite thought about if there will be a project that I'll kind of like settle into in my life. I have to assume so, you know, like as I kind of like get older and get more perspective and have like a, you know, I would say to come. okay, anybody else? Yes. Yeah. Okay, how do we choose the subjects for the portraits? So it's, sometimes I'll have a kind of a feeling like before I start, like, okay, I want to make something like this. And other times it'll just be like a moment, like something has come up, there's something that I've seen, there's a picture that I took, or there's a person that I met, and I said, one day I will draw you. Like the woman that I drew for this piece, I still remember the first day that I saw her, like 8 years ago. I was like, oh my god, I will draw you one day. And I've drawn her like four times, because she's like kind of quite my muse, I guess. And so, you know, at that moment, I knew that I wanted to draw this kind of sea deity, and I knew that she had a really strong relationship with water and with New Orleans. And so I was like, okay, this makes sense. Like, let's like take some pictures together and I'll draw you. So sometimes I have a kind of a really preconceived idea. Other times, It's, you know, like with these guys, it was like just a moment that happened. You know, I was outside, all these kids were kind of just playing around, and I was shooting some pictures. And I felt that I wanted to make a drawing of those guys just to really sort of tell the story of the, you know, of those kids. And so I just sort of chose it a little bit at random as far as like, you know, which sort of photograph and like image spoke to me because I draw from the pictures. I find that for me, like, I need to draw from pictures, it's a lot. I'm able to get a lot more sort of candid moments. And so, yeah. So it sort of depends on like where the idea is coming from, and I would say that it's either like just having seen a moment that I really want to capture, or it's having an idea in my mind that I feel like I really want to find the subject to fit. So yeah. Yes. Yeah, okay, so how long does it take to do the cutouts? So a cutout like this one, this is a drawing that's about to be cut out, will take between 1 and 2 weeks. The last series of prints that I made was like super, you know, like 11 feet tall, so the bases were, you know, whatever, bigger than my torso. So that would take almost a month. Those take like a month. So it takes a long time. Yes? I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last part.
There's a certain amount of, like, I think at a certain point for artists, it's utility of making things.
Yeah.
But when they're, what's the point of making things? What kind of difference are they going to make in the world if there's so much stuff that really exists? What do you have to say to artists like that?
Yeah, so he asked about the feeling that when you come up against that, the feeling of the futility of making things. And that's definitely something that I struggle with and have struggled with. And I think that that's why my path is so kind of twisting and turning, because I'm just constantly kind of writhing under that question and how do you answer it and how do you just like find different ways and different methods and different forms of engagement and just sort of moving through answering that question all the time. And so, you know, my answer would be constantly try different things, constantly try different avenues. And for me, you know, the whole thing about kind of why I started as a street artist and am now doing all these other things is that the thing, you know, I loved graffiti and I loved street art, but it was more for me about trying to find context and trying to find meaning in the creation of these objects. And so I feel like almost any time when you can find a kind of a context for yourself, and for me working on the street was just one kind of context, building a boat and showing up in someone's town was another kind of context, and building a house was another kind of context again. So I think that I would suggest just trying to like build community and seek context, and meaning will start to be generated out of that, and you won't feel as isolated in the futility of making. Yeah. So the question was about the permanence of work. And so for me, because I'm making paper cuts and prints, I always have like the original. So I think when I first started, people would be like, oh, you're so zen, you're so pure, and this thing disappears. And I'm like, nah, really, I have a copy. So there's that. And I used to photograph them a lot more than I do, because I'm traveling so much and so fast these days, I tend to end up not going back as much to the places where I was. And I kind of don't like that. I love to see the process and to see sort of how the area has like sort of responded and changed. And so I would like to be able to photograph and document them more than I do. But you know, I think that the making is more important. So I just try to keep up with it as best I can. Yeah. So I just roll it up and just like cross my fingers and wish for the best. Oh, lots and lots of things get damaged in the process. Yeah. So how did I first, I was a waitress all through college, and I waitressed until I basically started selling artwork out of my studio, which was like a funny, awkward, like, but awesome moment where like somebody would buy something and then their next door neighbor would buy something, and then, you know, just kind of like word of mouth, I survived that way for about a year or two, and then I started to become able to survive from selling work. You know, and that's one of those things where I've always felt a kind of divided about being somebody who feels so connected to kind of everyday life, but then I make work that gets sells for like crazy amounts of money, which for me is like quite out of touch from my kind of daily experience and the daily experience of most people that I know. And you know, it's kind of just like, for me, it's just like the devil I love. Like I'm like, okay, it's this thing that makes me feel a little bit uncomfortable, and at the same time, it's a total blessing, because when I need to raise money for a project that I want to do, it really allows me to have the freedom to kind of sell things and make money. And so it's, I waitressed, and then I slowly made my own way, and then I entered into the commercial art world, and you know, now for better and worse, there I am. Anyone else? Questions? Yeah.
Yeah, so she asked about if the image shadow puppet was visual or about the storytelling.
chat up with them, so kind of quite recently. But there was just something really striking for me about the silhouette of the image, and just about even just thinking, it was all, this I can see a lot actually, where somebody will tell me something, and I'll get this image in my head, and I'm like, oh, it must be like this, and it must be like that, and then I find out that it's different. But because I became so invested in my daydream of what it would be like, I then almost have to go and do that thing. And so, and I wouldn't say it was necessarily like that with shadow puppets, but it was a little bit similar, where I just like had this idea of what they would be like, and then I just wanted to make something, which kind of, you know, was inspired by that. Okay, so you had your hand up. I'm sorry, can you just repeat that loud? I think that I'm just gonna off the top of my head say Mississippi.